Today we're going to continue our study on the prophets of doom. Lesser known prophets in the Old Testament who preached doom to the people of Israel. Today we're going to be talking about the prophet Joel. And no, that's not Billy Joel, even though I'm sure Cody could play a good piano man. But Joel is an interesting prophet in general, because we don't really know the time period that Joel preached. We believe it was sometime between the year 900 BC and 400 BC. But we don't really know where in that scale his preaching actually took place. That's a period of 500 years. The United States is a little over 300 years old, so it's a significant gap there. But particularly, his message is a timeless one, one that works in that period and one that works for us today. And we're going to read a passage from the book of Joel. You may not know it from the book of Joel, but it's a passage you're probably familiar with, because I preach on these exact words every single Pentecost, because Peter repeats this passage in the book of Acts. So, as we turn to it, let's look at it with a new set of eyes, these old familiar words. From the book of Joel, chapter 2, verse 28 through 32. And afterwards, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, your old men will dream dreams, your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will show wonders in heaven and on earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance. As the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now, we don't know much about the prophet Joel. In fact, the only time that the prophet Joel is mentioned outside of the book of Joel is those words that Peter says in the book of Acts, which is interesting. We don't know much about this person, but yet Peter thought it was important enough to repeat his words on that day of Pentecost when the Spirit came to those early apostles. But what's interesting about his preaching is when it took place. Joel was preaching to the people of Israel when a plague of locusts was ravaging the Middle East. Both Judah and the other nations around Judah and Israel were being taken advantage of or destroyed by this plague of locusts. Now, locusts are interesting. I mean, today when we hear of a plague or locust, what do we think of, right? Some creature coming and eating farmland. I don't own a farm. Who here owns a farm? Well, not many of us, right? I don't know what would happen in my life if a plague of locusts came by. I mean, maybe they'd cut my grass in the spring so I wouldn't have to. I would say maybe food prices would rise some, but I saw a dozen eggs for $20 last week in the grocery store. I don't know much higher they can get. We hear about these plagues, but we don't really understand the pain and the doom that they caused. If you owned a family farm and your only means of food was what you could grow in your backyard, if a plague of locusts came and ate everything you had worked hard to grow, you would have to watch as your family starved. That's the doom that these people were facing. And it was hard for them. Because back then, as many people today see, they think that only darkness comes on those people who are unfaithful. So all of these good, God-fearing people came out to see this plague affecting their crops, and they wondered, why? Why was this doom coming to me? But that's how darkness is. If the sun's darkened, it affects everyone here, even the faithful people and the unfaithful equally. I know it's probably not surprising to many of you, but when I read about darkness, I think of other times in history when a darkness came upon a group of people. In particular, I thought about the French Revolution. Now, it was an interesting time for a man named the Marquis de Lafayette. I know I've talked about him before. He was an interesting man because he believed in his principles. He believed that all people were created equal, and he believed that tyrants should not rule over anyone. In fact, before the French Revolution, he came to America, where he was commissioned a major general and fought alongside General George Washington to free the American people from tyrants before he went back and did the same in his home country. He was an interesting man because he truly believed in his principles. He talked to our forefathers about freeing their slaves because he thought that all men, regardless of their race, were equal. He thought that property should not be a requirement to vote. He thought that whether you are poor or if you are rich, you should have an equal say in your government. He was an enlightened man in a time that wasn't quite ready for that. Now, the French Revolution was an interesting point in history, and a lot of those ideals became the law of the land in France, and he was excited. But quickly, those ideals of enlightenment became replaced with ideals of power, and a darkness came upon everyone. Eventually, the Marquis de Lafayette fled his home country of France, where he was captured by the Austrians and forced into a dark, damp prison. He was a good man, an enlightened man, but yet he succumbed to darkness. When doom comes for one person, it comes for us all. Now, I'm a little embarrassed to admit this, but I didn't know what a locust was till a few years ago. I didn't, right? I had heard about locusts before. I knew that they were some sort of bug, but I didn't know. So when I was in seminary and I was reading the book of Joel, I decided that, well, now was the time for me to learn. So I Googled it. And they're grasshoppers. That's all they are. Grasshoppers. The little creature that I found in my backyard as a child, the same one that I put in a glass jar and fed crackers, even though I doubt they eat crackers. It's interesting how this little bug can be so devastating. But occasionally, we even today don't really understand why, but these grasshoppers will band together in swarms of millions and millions, and they'll come and they'll ravage the land. Even today, I was reading an article about India. And India's having plagues of locusts affect them right now. They are using military-grade drones to fight the locust. Drones! They are flying drones over locusts to try to get rid of these swarms. And do you know what's even more surprising? They're not working. The locusts are winning! Multi-million dollar pieces of equipment can't get rid of these little grasshoppers that I can catch in a jar. When doom comes, there's often no protecting us from it. The darkness comes and it gets over all of us equally, as it did the Marquis de Lafayette. But eventually, the Marquis de Lafayette made it out of that prison. He returned to his home country of France, where he sat down with his wife and his children, and they notice how those last few years that he came back to France were by far the happiest of his life. He came out of the darkness and found salvation. This may not be the message you need to hear today, the message from the book of Joel, the message that salvation can come from darkness. But eventually, at some period in life, that will be the message you need to hear. The message that even in your darkest moment, God is still there. God will come and be your salvation even when you don't expect it or you don't know how, or if it feels as if all hope is lost, hope in Christ is still there. That's the message that Joel gives us. The message that doesn't matter if it took place in 900 BC or if it took place in 2023. The darkness comes, but the light of Christ, the light of God, is even brighter. Now, church, will you pray with me? Almighty God, at points in our lives, it can feel as if a doom has consumed us, as if a plague of locusts is ravaging our hearts. But we know that the light of the resurrection is always there, guiding us to a greater tomorrow, a promised land that shall come. We know that you are a loving and compassionate God, and that is a lesson that we can learn today from your prophet, Joel. We pray all this in your Son's holy and great name. Amen.